gradually we got information about where, you know, other boats that are, because what I used to do, quite a few times during the day, as information about people who've been saved came through, they posted it down at the harbour. So I used to go down, see if there was any fresh information, take it back to the hotel.
So were you doing this for people that you knew, or just for the
anybody. Any information that was on the board, I would take back to the hotel and contact people. The Lakonia people, the travel agent, they were in contact with Madeira, obviously, now for, and we were all given. They opened the shop on Boxing Day, and we were all given
Maison Blanche,
£20 or £30 or something like that, and we were kitted out, and clothes and whatever you wanted. I had a jacket.
Because your clothes got shrunk in the sea.
That pullover.
What, that very one?
This very one. And I've got a hat inside, yeah, all came from Maison Blanche. But,
in Funchal, the name of the town.
Ian, they didn't get...
This was in what? Rita.
Is that the name of the town, Funchal?
Yeah, in Funchal, yes.
That's the harbour.
Yeah.
So you were given your clothes free and they gave us a £10.
Oh, and £10 note, but the serious thing for me, you see, was... that my trousers had shrunk. So I was walking about in these shrunk trousers. But when I'd bought the trousers here, you know, especially for the holiday, they were a bit too long. So they needed shortening. So instead of turning them up, cut off the bits, you know, and then trimmed them in like a tailor would. So of course, when I got these shrunk trousers, I was very cross with Nana, because I said, you shouldn't have cut off the bottoms, you know, you should have just turned them up.
Like an amateur would have.
But fortunately, they were very good trousers and they came down to length eventually, and so I was all right. So that was, what you call it, that was Madeira. And then we had the opportunity, we were given the opportunity. We could have gone home.
Yeah.
But, you know, it seems silly we got that far.
No, you don't want to go home to hysterical family and friends.
And off we went to and had a holiday in Las Palmas with Auntie Bevan and Uncle Wally.
And when did the impact of the experience sort of catch up with you?
I suppose. The real effect was to put everything into perspective. I never really was in shock or anything like that. You know, the realisation that a toothbrush and a comb and a handkerchief, you know, were far more important than the fur coats or the other things that we'd left behind. And that I think was the, you know, was a real impact for me anyway. A total reassessment of the things that were important. And
what other ways did it shift your perspective?
Tolerance, I suppose. The fact that I could, you know, things could go on around me that didn't bother me anymore, that might otherwise have done, but didn't bother me anymore because they didn't seem important.
So you could just smaller irritations?
Yeah. I think that's, you know, those are the two things.
So somehow what, that just that life's more, you know, life's more...
Well, life's more important. Yeah. Material things less important.
And small irritations less important.
That's right, yeah, right, yeah.
And so do you think if you hadn't had that experience, life since then would have been somehow different?
Could well have been. I would have been much more aware of material things, yeah, much more upset, and, you know, much more worried about money and things like that. I'm quite sure that's right, yeah.
So it just gave you a sort of tranquility that you might...
Yeah, have I think life. So. I find it hard to get upset about things now. Can't be bothered, yeah. You know. Not important.
Do you consciously think back to that event, or is it just an overall feeling?
No, not really. As far as I'm concerned, it's history. Every now and again, it's it's all right. It's fun to reminisce, but that doesn't. No more shock to the system to talk about the Lakonia than it is to talk about any of the other holidays that we've ever had.
Right.
So really, in that respect, I'm very fortunate.
So would you say overall it's been sort of beneficial?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
And did you go and see Titanic last year?
No.
Would you go, or would it be too...
I would have gone. Yeah. Then it would. You didn't go.
It's too close. Would be too close to
me. Yeah.
The memories.
Right.
There's your
manner. Yeah, I don't know about memories. And I think I would perhaps have been a little more sort of critical of you know, saying, well, you know, that really couldn't have happened. You've got to stage that. I'm sure that wouldn't have happened. Or things like that, you know. That was, I was just...
The film fakery.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. I would have seen it as a, you know, as a film and not as a as an actuality, I think, yeah.
Okay, so Pop, last question for this session is when I show this to Noah one day, what piece of advice would you give him when he's a sort of a certain age in terms of you know, how to get on in life?
Oh dear.
That's not an easy question.
No, I mean, I asked the question now, but in a way that Lakonia was a big life lesson.
Yeah, I think life is easier if you are tolerant, if you are prepared to listen, and if somehow you can form your own spectrum, as it were, of important things. You know, decide on what for you are important things, what for you are not such important things. Go for the important things. And don't get worried if everything doesn't go absolutely right. Just try again, see if you can do it some other way.
So in your life, what list of priorities did you build yourself? And did you, is it a list of priorities you built yourself after Lakonia, or did you always have them?
I think I always had them. And I suppose the most important for me, and I think both in terms of what I would like to have done and what I've actually done, is I think to be of, you know, to be of help, to be of service, and to be tolerant
to the community in general.
To the community.
That was always your highest priority.
Yeah, always, and it's always been like this. And I think again, it's very much a family thing. Because, you know, in the family, that's all I've always seen. You know, members of the family have always been involved in helping here, helping there, and you know, service things.
So who specifically are you thinking of? I mean, when you say that, what role models are you looking at?
Father, I suppose, because he was always very active in, you know, in social affairs. And then later on, of course, you know, the rest of the family. Somebody always seemed to be doing something for somebody.
Right. So you're talking about Nana's
family as well? Yeah.
Were there other people in on your side of the family that were sort of role models in that way?
Not really. Mostly your father, yeah.
And when you talk about tolerance, what do you mean there? You're saying that that's a very...
To listen to other people's point of view, to, you know, not to be selfish. You know, sometimes it pays to be a little bit selfish, but generally to be unselfish and always, you know, listen and help where you can.
That would be pretty good.